My name is Chadwick Phillips. I am an instructor for my own program called Hip Hop, History and the Arts. I started it last summer, and it's just been a blessing being on this journey, teaching every aspect of the arts. Is anybody else with those different avenues of art view? I'm a firm believer in every aspect of art being relative to each other, because it comes down to your imagination, and you're using your imagination to reach people. You're basically pulling people in to your creativity and to your imagination so they can see exactly what you think, how you feel artistically. It's an excellent way to connect people in all aspects and cultures of life. But today, there's one aspect of art that we're going to be focusing on, and that is poetry and the spoken word. Say poetry and the spoken word. A griot, or jelly, in French spelling, is a West African historian, storyteller, praise singer, poet, and musician. The griot is a repository of oral tradition. As such, they are sometimes also called bards. According to Paul Oliver in his book Savannah Syncopators, though, the griot has to know many traditional songs without error. He must also have the ability to exemplarize or current events, chance incidents in the passing scene. His wit can be devastating and his knowledge of local history formidable. Although they are popularly known as praise singers, griots may also use their vocal expertise for gossip, satire, or political comment. They came out of West Africa within the ancient times. In traditional culture, no griot can be without a jatigi, and no jatigi can be without a griot. The two are inseparable and worthless without the other. However, the jatigi can accept a loan of his griot to another jatigi. Most villages have their own griot, who told tales of births, deaths, marriages, battles, hunts, affairs, and hundreds of other things. Bakari Sumana, head of the Association of Bamako Griots in Mali from 1994 to 2003, was an internationally known advocate for the importance of the griot in West African society.
Do you see the wrinkle over my brow, the turned down corner of my lips? Or do you even have an inkling of the gravity of the flips I perform for you every day? Twisting and turning and contorting in every way, changing my history to allow you to have comfort in your present.
Down the Atlantic slave trade, it was a very tumultuous period of Africans being sent to America from different parts, different regions of the country. But one African that we're going to be focusing on is Phillips Wheatley. Phillips Wheatley was the first black poet in America to publish a book. She was born around 1753 in West Africa and brought to New England in 1761, where John Wheatley of Boston purchased her as a gift for his wife, Susanna Wheatley. Although they brought her into the household as a slave, the Wheatleys took a great interest in Phillips's education. Many biographers pointed to her precocity. Wheatley learned to read and write English by the age of 9, and she became familiar with Latin, Greek, the Bible, and selected classics at an early age. She began writing poetry at age 13, modeling her work on the English poets of the time, particularly John Milton, Thomas Gray, and Alexander Pope. Her poem on the death of the Reverend Mr. George Whitfield was published as a broadside in cities such as Boston, New York, and Philadelphia, and garnered Wheatley national acclaim. This poem was also printed in London. Over the next few years, she would print a number of broadsides elegizing prominent English and colonial leaders.
What is happiness? Is it a room full of adorable kittens? Or a pair of new, soft woolen mittens? Is it embracing the child inside, full of curiosity and questions, not afraid to hide? Perhaps it is laughing until your sides hurt, or running through a field uninhibited by the stigma of the dirt.
All right, so the next person I want you to write about is Langston Hughes. Langston Hughes was born February 1st, 1902 in Joplin, Missouri. As one of the founders of the cultural movement known as the Harlem Renaissance, he was one of the founders of Heavy Cat, which he practically defined in his essay, The Negro Artist and the Racial Mountain, in 1926. He was innovative in his use of jazz rhythms and dialect to depict the life of urban blacks in his poetry, stories, and plays, having provided the lyrics for the musical Street Scene in 1947, and the play that inspired the opera Troubled Island in 1949. In the 1960s, he returned to the stage with works that drew on black gospel music, such as Black Nativity in 1961. A prolific writer for four decades, he abandoned the Marxism of his youth, but never gave up protesting the injustices committed against his fellow African Americans. Some of the best artists, it's one thing I've noticed, I don't know if you guys have noticed this or not, some of the best artists, regardless of the art, are the ones who went through the most trepidation, you know? The ones who've been through like the most battles and journeys. And it's like, it sculpts up something that's very, very shining, something that's very beautiful that comes out of them in time. And then they get exalted for that, you know? For like going through what they had to go through, but still keeping their faith regardless of what was going on. And staying pure and original and super creative, and it just comes out as something that's just, it's like a wonder, it's like you can't even explain. And Langston Hughes was definitely one of those people. All right? Now, we're gonna go to the next chapter. Now mind you, I want you all to keep in mind what the similarities are between all of these different artists, all these different poets from the ancient times, now we're at the 1960s.
Never lost, but emotions wild. Faith keeps my track from yelling my attacks. I'm grateful. Try to say you understand the struggle. You can't. You know it. When you've been there, you've seen it, you lived it. I know, and for that, I'm grateful.
She's called the Global Renaissance Woman. Dr. Angelo was a celebrated poet, memoirist, novelist, educator, dramatist, producer, actress, historian, filmmaker, and civil rights activist. As a teenager, Dr. Angelo's love for the arts won her a scholarship to study dance and drama at San Francisco's Labor School. In 1960, Dr. Angelo moved to Cairo, Egypt, where she served as editor of the English language weekly, the Arab Observer. The next year, she moved to Ghana, where she taught at the University of Ghana School of Music and Drama, worked as feature editor for the African Review, and wrote the Ghanaian Times. With the guidance of her friend, the novelist James Baldwin, she began work on the book that would become I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings, published in 1970. I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings was published to international acclaim and enormous popular success. Dr. Angelo's words and actions continue to stir our souls, energize our bodies, liberate our minds, and heal our hearts.
A poet is someone who understands his worth. Like Archimedes, he'll lift the earth, and the world will shake, rumbling with earthquakes, but not a crack in the ground. No upturned mountains to be found, because the only thing shattered will be your mind.
We are gonna go far to this place called hip-hop. Time went on. You had music artists who were speaking and poetry within song. Hip hop started its embryo phase in the Bronx, New York. Alright, a man named DJ Kool Herc moved to New York City, the Bronx, from Jamaica. And he had these big speakers, huge speakers, and he had turntables, you know, where he'd scratch. And people would come to these parks and be like, what's going on? This is amazing. I've never heard nothing like this, right? Then a man named Africa Bambaataa. He used to bring dancers together that used to be in gangs.
I said, instead of fighting, why don't you guys dance it out? And the subject matter, what was being talked about within the poem and the rhythms, had to do with positivity, had to do with overcoming, had to do with what was going on under the black community.
Kevin Everett, studio professional, 2002.
The whole world is living. We should be ashamed that we let time remain.